I'm glad that you're all here with us this evening. We're doing something a little different for our Good Friday service, something a little unconventional. Tonight we are having a funeral for our beloved Jesus, a good Midwestern funeral that we're all familiar with, that might look quite different than what they would have done on that Good Friday so many years ago. But perhaps it will give us the opportunity to journey with the people who would have been there and feel the emotions they would have felt. So on behalf of Jesus' family, we're grateful that you are here to attend and to celebrate the life of Jesus of Nazareth. Join me in prayer. Gracious God, we are humbled by the opportunity to remember your story and your love for us. Lord, I pray that as we enter into this service together, that you open our hearts and minds, and that we hear from you tonight, that you work inside of us and transform us into new creations. Lord, thank you that we can remember this Good Friday, and that it leads to a glorious Easter. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, I'm going to invite Greg Reed up, and he is going to read an obituary for Jesus.
Jesus of Nazareth, age 33. Returned to his heavenly home today. He died at 3 p.m. on Golgotha Hill, outside of Jerusalem, after being sentenced to death by Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor. The cause of death was severe torture and extreme blood loss as a result of crucifixion. Jesus was born to Joseph, a Galilean carpenter who preceded him in death, and Mary, who was present at his death and burial. Jesus is also survived by his brothers, sisters, many disciples, and 11 close friends. Judas Iscariot preceded him in death. From a humble beginning, born in a stable in the small town of Bethlehem, Jesus worked alongside his father as a carpenter until he began his public ministry at approximately 30 years of age. He began to receive public notoriety as the word of his unusual occurrences surrounding his teaching spread. At the touch of his hand, the blind regained their sight. The deaf, their hearing was restored. He healed the diseased and the crippled with just his voice. He brought life to the dead. He spoke of loving God and others in revolutionary ways. Last Sunday, Jesus rode into Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover as crowds praised him, hailing him as king. The day before his death, he held a supper with those closest to him to enjoy what would have been his last Passover meal. In his typical loving way, he washed the feet of those in attendance. Before breathing his last breath, those present at the cross stated they heard Jesus ask God to forgive those who had abused him, saying they really didn't understand what they were doing. They heard him ask his beloved friend John to take care of Mary, his mother. They watched with anguish as he cried to God, why have you forsaken me? They wept inconsolably as they heard him say, it is finished. His body was then placed in a tomb, generously given to the family by Joseph of Arimathea. A boulder was rolled in front of the entrance by the order of Pontius Pilate, who also placed Roman soldiers on guard outside the tomb. In lieu of flowers, the family requests that donations be made to the local Widows and Orphans Fund, or anyone you know who might be needed. They also have a special request that in honor of Jesus, you simply live your life loving God and loving others, something that would have greatly pleased him.
If you would, turn in your red hymnals to number 14. We'll sing together, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." If you would please stand and sing all four verses.
Jesus I knew was a welcoming man. He made you feel like you belonged. You were welcome to Jesus' presence. I was the youngest of his disciples, yet he always included me, as youngsters aren't always accepted or listened to, especially when there's a big brother or older man in the room. Yet Jesus listened to me. He let me ask questions and answered them. Jesus included me, and I felt like I had a place of value when I was with him. Jesus had an affectionate nickname for my brother James and I. He called us the Sons of Thunder. We were quite rough at the beginning, I guess. We could have really made a mess of things if Jesus hadn't been patient enough to work with us, and he did. Jesus taught each of us. He made us better, especially Peter, James, and me. We were three stubborn boys with tons of zeal and energy. We leapt before we looked, and we spoke before we thought. He poured attention into us, attention that I don't feel like we deserved. I think he knew who we could become over time. He saw past the chaos that we were in our youth, and I am humbled and changed by his love. Just a few days ago, he brought the three of us up a hill, and we saw him transfigured. He changed before us, and we saw Moses and Elijah with him. Can you believe it? We got to see God's glory through Jesus. How did I ever deserve that gift? Me, John, the young and crazy son of thunder? I am nothing apart from the love of Jesus that he has for me. I am his beloved. It is because of Jesus that my life matters.
My name is Mary. I live in a town on the coast of Galilee called Medalla. I'm a disciple of Jesus, but that doesn't even begin to describe who he was to me. I owe him everything. He literally saved me from the power of hell. See, a few years ago, my life was very different. I was very different. I was dominated by seven evil spirits. My suffering at their hands was severe. When they weren't controlling me, I lived a life of constant fear. I worked that they would come back, knowing at any moment my thoughts and actions wouldn't be my own. Regardless of how hard I fought for control, my efforts were always in vain. I couldn't overpower the forces. I believed the lies they whispered, that I was worthless, that no one would ever love me. I stopped taking care of myself. Why bother? I've been told I was frightened and withheld. My hair was a mess, my cheeks pale and sunken, my eyes glazed and distant. People avoided me, which only fed the lies the demons spewed. Then one day, everything changed. This man, Jesus, he set me free. He spoke to the demons, commanded they leave me alone. I don't know how to fully explain what happened next. My nerve-wracked mind was suddenly calm. I felt like I could breathe fully for the first time. I could actually see clearly. The fog I had spent my life wandering through was lifted. I saw Jesus smiling at me. I was this wild-eyed woman cowering in a corner, but when he looked at me, he saw beyond all of that. He saw who I was created to be. He healed my body, mind, and soul. I left my home and followed him. It didn't matter where he was going or what he was planning to do. I only knew I wanted to be part of it. I needed to be with him. If he could change my life, I could only imagine what he could do for others. And I was devoted to whatever I could to make sure people got to encounter Jesus. I could spend hours and hours telling you about the amazing things I saw him do. Healing people, raising the dead to life, things I'll never forget. But now, as I stand before you feeling more sorrow and emptiness than I ever have, what I remember most is his laugh. I remember his eyes that seemed to look at me with a love I can't explain. I remember his hands full of so much healing and power that he used to perform miracles and play with children. I remember how he lit up when I talked about God. I remember how he looked when someone rejected his teachings. A deep sadness seemed to overtake him. I remember these things, but I don't know how to get the images of the last few days out of my head. When I close my eyes, I see him standing in Pilate's hall. I hear the leaders calling for his blood, and I silently himself. I don't think I'll ever be able to forget Pilate condemning Jesus to death as the angry mob shouted, "Crucify him!" Hadn't they heard Pilate say he found no fault in him? I tried shouting out that he did nothing wrong. He isn't right. You can't kill this innocent man. But my voice was lost among the crowd screaming, "Jesus." I watched as they led him to the center of the city. I cringed as they mocked him. The soldiers spit on him. They beat him mercilessly. I didn't want to watch. I couldn't look away. Through my tears, I begged them, "Please stop." But they just laughed and continued beating him. I wonder if the day will ever come when I forget what it felt like to stand at the cross watching him suffer. It was more than I could bear, but I needed to be there. I wanted him to know he wasn't alone. I couldn't leave him alone. I listened to his pain-filled cries, and it seemed as if the earth went dark. It felt like I was wrapped in a shadow. Everything was cold, and the world seemed to hold his breath. When he took his last breath, I felt like all hope died with him. I stayed as they took him off the cross. I watched until his body was placed in the tomb. I wanted to stay, but I don't think I've ever been so tired in my life. And now I have to say goodbye to the most extraordinary man I have ever known. A man who noticed me, saved me, treated me with dignity and respect. We know people talked about Jesus allowing women to travel with him. We heard the comments they made, but Jesus didn't care and neither did I. They didn't know him. If they did, they wouldn't have understood. I had to follow him. I wouldn't trade my time with Jesus for anything. His life profoundly impacted me. I don't know how to say goodbye, and maybe that's okay, because I know the impact he had on me will continue to live on as I strive to love God and love people the way he did. I love you always, my friend, my Savior, my Rabbi.
I'm Peter, one of his disciples. He's actually more like a brother to me. Jesus, James, and John and I, we did life together. We had a special connection that kind of went beyond friendship. I know that doesn't make any sense, and I can't really explain it. There's not a lot I can really explain right now. Like these last 24 hours, I can't explain how I'm standing here and he's lying on a borrowed tomb. I keep replaying these past events in my mind, and I'm trying to find some sense, trying to find some answers, something that could explain or could prove that he was who he said he was. Because right now, I'm desperately trying to comprehend how the Messiah, the Son of God, could be lying in the grave. I met Jesus only a few years ago. My brother Andrew introduced us. He had heard this John the Baptist, another radical guy, but he was talking about the Lamb of God. Well, he told me he hadn't introduced us. So when I met him, it was a moment that was etched into my mind. There was just something so intriguing about him that, well, I left everything. My family, I had a lucrative fishing career. followed him on an incredible journey, one that's led me here to this place. It's not at all where I thought we'd end up. You know, I watched him heal people. He raised the dead, and I saw it with my own eyes. How could death defeat him now? I mean, because of him, I walked on water. Seriously, on water. He could control the elements, but he couldn't avoid the cross. How does that happen? I mean, I believed that he was the Son of the living God, and I believed it with all my heart. But as I look back and see everything that's transpired, I can't help but wonder if maybe he was just another rabbi. I mean, because seriously, why would the Savior suffer the way he did? I mean, he used to talk about death. He talked about dying. He would say things that his death was necessary. It was for us. But that was before. And last night, during dinner, he talked about a traitor. Oh, I'm so furious. And without thinking, I looked at him and I said, I would never betray him. And I'd be willing to go to prison for him. And I would even die for him. And you know what he said to me? He said he was praying for me. He asked God to help keep me strong. He told me that before the rooster crowed this morning that I would betray him 3 times. I didn't believe it. But what was I supposed to do? I mean, you weren't there. I mean, you don't know what it was like when the soldiers came and arrested him, the anger and the cruelty that were in their eyes. I mean, what was I supposed to do? I mean, I was afraid for my life. I mean, I had to tell him that I didn't know who this guy was. I mean, I told him I wasn't one of his followers. And that's when I heard it. That blasted rooster crow. And then I saw Jesus. And he turned. And in the crowd that had gathered there, he somehow found me. And it was like we were the only two people in Jerusalem. And I knew then, you know what I've done. And I could see the look in his eyes. I never felt such intense fear and sorrow and shame. And now he's gone. And I have no idea what I'm supposed to do now. Jesus, I am so sorry.
Joy. We also worried about the responsibility and burden
set on his shoulders. As a mother, you want to do anything you can for your children. But how humbling is it to think that my child had come to do everything for me? My heart is full of pride at the life my son has lived and the people impacted through his life. And now I must do what no parent should ever have to do. I must lay my son to rest. Though our time together was not nearly enough, in committing his body to the earth, we give over him to you, God, the one who cares for his spirit. Lord, bless him and keep him. Lord, make his face shine upon him. Be gracious to him. The Lord look upon him with favor and give him peace. Though tonight we have stepped into the mode of a funeral to process Good Friday in a creative way, we know truth in you, God. God, we thank you that we know what it feels like to lose loved ones. We thank you for the gift of Jesus in our lives. We thank you that though our hearts are filled with loss and sadness, that we can find comfort in you. Amen.
Very good grievers, and I think this is a day where we can work on that just a little bit.
because the more we understand and grieve what it is that Jesus did for the likes of us, the more impact Sunday will have on us, and the more likely we are going to be to share what we've experienced with the risen Savior. Thank you so very much for joining us this evening. As you leave, if you go to the left, correct? Okay, to the left, there will be some snacks and some things that you can partake in so that we can get to know one another. Mariah and I are both very new at what we're doing and both very excited. I'm very excited to have found her. And so we would love to get to know each other a little bit better, and that includes these bodies of believers who have come together tonight. So if you are willing to stay, when you leave this room to your left, there will be some refreshments for you. Thank you all for coming.